Hey, welcome to Education Futures Reads Book Chat. This is a monthly discussion, and I'm John Moravec. We're discussing Cathy O'Neil's provocative book, Weapons of Math Destruction, How Data Increases Inequality and Threatens Democracy. And she examines and critiques the widening roles that mathematical modeling plays in our society. And in an era where we're being really, really obsessed with measurement, there's some huge implications for the world of education. So Cathy is unable to join us today, and so we're joined here instead by Dr. Cristóbal Cobo, who's a great friend. We've been working for, now we're discovering, we've had projects going for 10 years now, starting with collaborations between Minnesota and Mexico, and we've expanded quite a bit more internationally. So Chris, I'll let you introduce yourself, I guess. So hi.
Hi, John. It's good to talk to you. I mean, it's incredible that we have been for 10 years sharing projects and crazy ideas all around the world. So I'm very happy to be here. And I have to say as well that I celebrate these open conversations that you promote because they're super important and now more these days in which there are plenty of noise in the conversations between education and technology. I'm Chris. I'm running a research center here in Uruguay, Ceibal Foundation is named, and I collaborate in research with my colleagues at the Oxford Internet Institute in the UK. It could be the brief overview. I'm currently now in Montevideo.
Great, and we're experimenting with a new format by connecting with you through Skype, and we're live streaming this on Facebook. So I really don't want this to be much of an interview, but rather something much more dynamic where we can take advantage of Facebook's commenting to share our thoughts, really get things moving. And to get things moving, I guess I'll start off with some questions for you. And we invite the online community then to jump in through your responses. And this is really an open conversation. You don't need to have read Weapons of Math Destruction to participate. But we suspect that you'll be very, very, very excited to read it after this discussion. So please join in by posting your questions or thoughts in the stream's comment box, or join us on Twitter by using the hashtag EFReads. So, Chris, I suppose to start off a bit, let's get towards on the basics. What is data literacy? And what does this really mean for educators?
So for something like 10, 15 years, we've been broadly talking about digital literacy or information computer literacy, or the Europeans call it the computer's driving license even. So in most of those discussions, the focus was on the master or on the use of the devices. And then we learned that even if you are very good using word processors or browsers or other kind of tools, that was not enough in order to make the best of the technology in the learning environment. So then the focus was much more on producing contents, and the Web 2.0 and all these sort of social practices came into the world of education. Now, I guess one of the following trends had much more to do with the mobile, the portability of the production of information. And then you are not only generating contents aware, but also you can be streaming data that you might not be aware of. And that can be incredibly powerful if we make a good use of it, but also can open a really large number of problems and concerns that we have to take care of. And this, in the same way that the web in the early years used to be a topic only for techie people, very geekies, now has been a problem of a broader concern. So data literacy, in a way, has to do with how can we bring these discussions of the how powerful can be the data in the world of education, but we have to understand opportunities, but also we have to be deeply aware of the number of problems that can be bring into discussion. So to briefly summarize the answer is the data literacy is another layer of the digital skills that has to do with understanding when this can be useful, but understand as well what are the concerns that we have to take into account at the personal, institutional, and the national level as well.
Okay, thank you very much. You recently organized a conference on big data in education. I believe it was last April. Can you explain or ex- explore a bit more in detail what this big data movement is about and what it really means for those of us in the world of learning?
Okay, no. First of all, there's a number of events, I guess, simultaneous events, large events worldwide talking about these topics. It's such a relevant matter. It's super trendy. It's not only taking place in the world of education, of course, in the elections as well, as we have discussed earlier. But I guess the main discussion today is how can we make from this really powerful instrument something that can be used with positive purpose for the teachers and for the learners, and not only being used for marketing interests or political interests. So this is what we discussed here last April, as you said. We invite people from a number of universities. Open University in the UK, for instance, is developing a number of policies which suggests a very useful framework to take into account, which state as a main premise, and I think it's useful to bring into this conversation, transparency. Transparency as the golden rule to talk about big data. We brought people from the learning analytic community, which is also one of the big players now. They will organize an event in Vancouver in next March, and we will go there. And people who has a much more critical or cynical point of view of what could be the problems, like Cathy O'Neil, I would say Neil Selvin also is one of those who say, "Hey guys, you really need to be really well aware of some of the problems that this thing is behind." So I guess, and the last week in Belgium there was also a big event on big data, open data, and data literacy. So I would say that there's many people open discussions in this area, and this is because we are aware that we have a plenty of skills and literacies that we still have to develop.
All right, cool. In Weapons of Math Destruction, Cathy O'Neil warns us that these algorithms that we trust to help us make, you know, these so-called fair decisions by using, you know, big data concepts actually perpetuate inequality. And so that these are the so-called weapons of math destruction in her book. So she argues that they not only increase inequality, but also threaten democracy as well. So some examples that she had was like Facebook's new trending topics algorithm. We're broadcasting this on Facebook, so I think a lot of people are familiar with that. And it's really a non-transparent means of how they filter stories and news to people. And the thing is that 63% of Facebook users report that they get their news from Facebook. And there's some really scary implications because it uses software, not humans, to filter the news. And I think we've seen a lot of hate speech, fake news, and other sort of noise get in there. And that seems to be leading to a lot of problems. And in the United States, there were some implications for this in our presidential election. We have data-driven policing. You know, we're trying to be predictive in predicting crime and where it happens, but it really winds up perpetuating racial and socioeconomic bias by targeting, areas that are not rich and white. And decisions like credit, insurance rates, and access to colleges and schools are increasingly based on how we, as humans, fit into these software algorithms. So I guess my question for you, Chris, is where do we see these big decisions be made in education that are based on algorithms?
Great question. So just to put the question in context, I guess big data exists from a number of years, and now we are much more aware, as we said. But, I mean, since the beginning of credit cards, algorithms have been taking analysis and shaping our activities, our behaviors into patterns. And so banks have been for many, many decades suggesting if I are either attractive consumers or risky consumers or people who can get into trouble. So this is not new at all. But now the sources of information are diversifying. That's why, as Cathy O'Neil suggests, when this thing is having a much larger implication in our daily life, it's really important to talk about openness in terms of how those algorithms are being deployed or are being used, or what are the decisions that are taken based on those algorithms. Because she says something that I really support, which is there is not such a thing as an objective algorithm. this an algorithm at the end of the day is focusing the importance of some aspects and dismissing the other ones. So when you do that, you really have a subjective way of understanding reality. And this is incredibly risky when you are talking about learning or when you're assessing not only the students, but also the teachers. So in order to move forward, the challenge is, in the same way that we were discussing the relevance of open access 10 years ago with the creation of Creative Commons and the open access movement in science, now the, one of the challenges is to have open access or full transparency or disclosure of those algorithms that have implications with the citizens. And this is a discussion that is not broadly adopted today. So when we have this small community who manage, produce, and administrate the data, and we have a large community of data producers, because at the end of the day, we are data producers, despite that we are not aware of, we have to reduce this data imbalance or inequality and really explain in a transparent, meaningful, and not really techy way what are the implications and what are the responsibilities of the institutions that are behind that. If we don't do that, the data inequality will still persist, I would say.
So as a reminder for folks joining us in the live stream, you can post your comments and questions in the comments box, which I think is below there. And there is no need to have read Cathy O'Neil's book to participate. It's merely a provocation that's driving this discussion. And we're really reorienting a conversation around the world of education, which she touched on a bit, but we're, I think, really working on focusing a whole lot more. So, Chris, who ultimately controls the data on students that we gather in education? Where does all this all go?
This is an important question. I am afraid I don't have the answer, but we have some ways of approach to that. So when the internet appears, one of the main things that happen is it removes the middleman. So we don't have to go through people who sell the things. We can go directly to the providers and we can jump some of the stages and we can reduce the prices. But at the same time that some of the middlemen or stakeholders disappear, we have new ones. So people tend to think that Facebook is the main source of manipulation of data. But at the end of the day, Facebook is only the middleman. I mean, I'm saying Facebook, but could be equally applicable to Skype and could be applicable to WhatsApp and Google and other companies. And the governments in other instances. So the question is, to whom are they providing the information that is collected from us? Collected from us because we, in a naive way, we have accept the terms and conditions without putting a lot of attention into that. But when we analyze, for instance, the last election, and we see that the candidates were the ones who, at the end of the day, were processing that information collected from the telecommunication companies, we understand that there is a really large number of people involved into that. And the question that I have is, why can we take the good practices of those experiences and bring them into education? And of course, removing the bad ones. Removing the bad ones means to provide a much more transparent policy in terms of how is the data of the students being used, what are the commitments of the governments, and to what extent that information is well protected in terms of encryption, repurposing of the data, and of some of the other, of some other problems that may show up. So in that sense, we in education have a diminished way of approaching big data in education, and it's time to catch up with the good things, removing the bad ones, and making them to work on this, on the service of education.
Hey, thanks. My wonderful wife, Kelly, asks, how can students, parents, and teachers educate themselves to understand big data so it's useful in facilitating learning when it seems that those who are developing the algorithms do so in order to present information in a way that is beneficial to their causes or their perspectives or their agendas?
That's a great question, I guess. This is a matter of flows of innovation. Usually, these days, is a much more top-down way of using and exploiting big data. And I guess the commitment that governments, universities, centers for research, technology developers have is one to provide these instruments to make to simple citizens to understand that in a way that can make them meaningful. For instance, discussions like environment or open access, which at the very beginning were very technical discussions and then were embraced by the community and they become socially cool to talk about these sort of things, they got at the end of the day a massive support because people understood the main keys of those discussions. And we have to have something similar with open data. When Snowden came into the discussion, I guess one of the main benefits of that disclosure of the things that were happening with the NSA was people who didn't put a lot of attention into that, they say, oh gosh, this can really affect me and I have to better understand this thing. Of course, there are plenty of work to do in that sense, but I guess we have to translate these complicated discussions into something that is understandable for a 5-year-old kid who is the one who is also providing data at the end of the day.
I like that a lot. I think that there's also opportunities for institutions to really game the system a bit and manipulate the data to make themselves look great. Do you see any examples of that where institutions are doing that?
So we have today a crisis of trust, which is affecting a number of institutions today. And I'm afraid that in education that is starting to happen as well. So we have at least two approaches. One is to deny everything and continue moving in the current direction. And the other one is hacking the system. Yeah. So to say, you know what, I'm not going to provide this information or I'm going to disclose the information that you are managing on my behalf without my permission and to provide a more transparent way to understand those conflicts. I guess one of the practices that is important to take into account as a good example is the increasing number of watchdogs initiatives, which are saying, hey, you know what, government, you shouldn't be using those algorithms without people's permission, or you shouldn't be allowed to repurpose the data that you collect for this tool and reapply them for these other purposes. So the more empowered the community will be, the more likely that governments and telecommunication companies will be in a better position to say, you know what, we have to open this one-to-one or many-to-many conversation in order to make this thing a dialogue and not only a top-down, one-to-many stream kind of practice, which is the one that we are seeing these days. And this is only... So far, we have talked about only the legal bit, but we also have the ethical one. I mean, what has to do with rankings, for instance, all the things that we say on behalf of underage kids are really sensitive in terms of to what extent that could be ethically acceptable that someone is taking decisions for those kids if their parents of those they know nothing out of that, and also the thing get even more complicated when we understand that the institutions are not technically savvy enough to make good analysis of this information. Because when you may find really strong correlations between A and B, and you can design policies out of that. But we all know that this could be incredibly risky because those correlations may not explain causality. So in science, we learned for the last 20 or 40 years that the more you open the discussions in science, the more consistent and robust is the science and the possibilities of identifying mistakes. This is something that needs to happen also with big data and education.
All right, well, thanks so much. As a reminder, folks joining us on the live stream can post their comments and questions in the comments box below. You bring up a really great point about ethics and ethical dilemmas that are emerging. And I want to share this excerpt from the book. She writes that students in the Chinese city of Zhongxiang had a reputation for acing the national standardized test, or the Gaokao, and winning places in China's top universities. It did so well, in fact, that authorities began to suspect they were cheating. Suspicions grew in 2012, according to a report in Britain's Telegraph, when the provincial authorities found 99 identical copies of a single test. So the next year, as students in Chongxiang arrived to take the exam, they were dismayed to be funneled through metal detectors and forced to relinquish their cell phones, some sort of tiny transmitters disguised as pencil erasers, and once inside, the students found themselves accompanied by 54 investigators from different school districts. And a few of those investigators crossed the street to a hotel where they found groups positioned to communicate with the students through their transmitters. The response to this crackdown and cheating was volcanic. Some 2,000 stone-throwing protesters gathered in the street outside the school. They chanted, "We want fairness. There is no fairness if you don't let us cheat." It sounds like a joke, but they're absolutely serious. The stakes of the students were high. As they saw it, they faced a challenge either to pursue an elite education and prosperous career or stay stuck in their provincial city, a relative backwater. And whether or not it was their case, they had a perception that others were cheating. So preventing the students in Chongxiang from cheating was unfair in a system in which cheating was the norm. Following the rules amounts to a handicap. Just ask the Tour de France cyclists who were annihilated for 7 years straight by Lance Armstrong and his doping teammates.
I love the example.
I mean, so in this area, does following the rules amount to a handicap?
You and I, we've been discussing for a long time this phrase, don't value what you measure, measure what you value. And we have this problem that we are living in a society that is obsessed with what you can measure, and what you cannot measure seems to be irrelevant. And this discussion has been landing into the world of PISA, for instance. And despite that, criticizing PISA as a useless piece of information, again, the big question is, what about all those kind of learnings that you cannot measure with a tool like that? And this is to better understand the limitations of those kind of tools. And the example that you give from China is beautiful because it's another one more of those examples in which we stress the focus on the product and not in the process. So there's this wonderful book from Elizabeth Lodge, who published it in MIT Press. It's called The War of Learning. And she mentioned something beautiful, which is very aligned with the example that you gave from China. She said that some students who are getting used to being controlled when they submit an essay or an assignment in the university, whose papers are scanned through the Turnitin software, which identify if students are cheating or not. You know that. And the students, they learn that at the end of the day, the Turnitin is an algorithm. So there are many ways of cheating the algorithm. So what the kids, they do is they translate the piece of text that they copy from somebody else into the Google Translator into one language, for instance, to French. Then they move it into Russian, and then they translate it back into English. So there's no way that the algorithm will be able to identify the students who are cheating. And this is a beautiful example of how can we misunderstand the control of the learning product without focusing on the process. If you don't understand the relevance of the process, this big data only will provide some data that those who are data illiterate, will fail. All the rest will find ways to escape that. So again, we are landing into the topic of ethical concerns, but also data inequality. Those who can play these new rules will succeed. And this is a problem of inequality again.
But is there a sort of honor among thieves when we talk about ethical cheating? So if universities are trying to game the system for a higher ranking, is it ethical to try to game the system yourself to get into university that is perhaps falsely presenting itself as well?
It's a good question. I have a number of problems with the rankings because they tend to benefit some kind of universities in some parts of the world as well. It's no surprise that many universities from the Southern Hemisphere are almost invisible in those rankings. But this is one part of that. The second part of it is, again, as we said earlier, you measure the things that you can measure, and you dismiss all the rest. I haven't seen a ranking so far. Maybe I'm wrong, but if you're aware of one, let me know. In which they measure the level of self-fulfillment of those kids when they graduate. No, of course, they measure the things that they can measure, the number of papers that they publish and the number of labs that they have. And it's a good thing to have that. But if you don't consider other kind of instruments which are outside of the current scopus of big data, those tools will also simplify the way that we understand reality. So we tend to think that today we are living in this kind of positivism with in steroids. But at the end of the day, it's a really simplification of reality. So my claim, I guess, is getting back to the transdisciplinary way of understanding the problems, not only focusing on the big picture, but also the small data also is important, and also a higher level of transparency, because with that we can have a much more diverse discussion. And I guess we are far away from those points so far.
Thanks so much. We got a comment from Facebook, or a question. Says, think of all the learning that goes into the process of cheating. Is this something that we ought to be celebrating instead of chastising?
That's a great question, and I fully support that view. I have a colleague, and I wrote in the book Innovación Pendiente, who said a lovely example of Quijote de la Mancha. You know Quijote in Spain, written from some Cervantes?
Don Quijote.
Don Quijote, that's right. So he said the following. He said, the internet is completely overloaded with summaries of Don Quixote. Endless amount of those. Short ones, long ones, bad ones, good ones. Some of them based on chapters, some of them the big picture. So this colleague was saying, what about instead of punishing those students who use somebody else's summary, why don't we ask the students to collect several summaries of the Don Quixote? And I compare them, identify the best of them and the worst of them, and identify some of the strengths and make an analysis throughout these different sources. And I guess we are much more living in this world in which it's not only one source, the one that is relevant, but it's the way how do you deal with all those kind of different kind of information. So when this colleague is mentioning that it's important to value those kind of mental process to understand how to browse through these different ways to scale the Turnitin focus, spotlight, I think there's value in that. So there's value in hacking, and hacking can be also be ethical if you teach the students how to do it. When you go to MIT, one of the first things that you see is the whole system at MIT encourage you to do hacking without breaking any legal rule. And you can do that. But it's focusing on collaboration and creativity and changing the mindset, many things that we have discussed earlier.
Very cool. I suppose this really links together then with ideas around assessment in schools. So what's your take?
Well, this is a topic that I've been working a lot for the last 2 years here in Uruguay. And despite that you may see in pretty much every educational system in the world that they all embrace innovation, most of them embrace the use of technology in the system, you hear very little discussions on innovation in the assessment. Because it's boring. Assessment is not as trendy as buying a new toy, a new device to bring into the classroom. And I guess this is a pending discussion. I call it impending innovation in the book, but it's basically how can we expand, enhance, diversify what you value as a learning outcome? This is not a war against the traditional standardized test or the traditional ways of assessing the amount of information that you may have, but it's a call to diversify and also valuing other things. I mean, all the digital badges is a kind of, or the e-portfolios are different approaches to say we could value other things. So when a student along the school or the university is developing all the kind of learning practices outside of the curriculum, outside of the classroom, today with the big data and all these social network tools, we are in a much better way, in a much better shape to value and recognize those as a learning outcomes today. So it's not a matter that we don't have the data. It's not a matter that we don't like innovation. It's a matter of changing the mindset. And we don't need a national policy to say, why don't we value, recognize this kind of expanded curriculum? it's a matter of teachers who can have find the time, which is not always easy, to say, let's find these other ways to collect, recognize, promote the success practices and also the failures, because there's plenty of learning out of that as well.
Well, thanks. We got a question on Facebook that I think that relates to that. It came in Spanish, so looking in English. It says, how to incorporate in the students and teachers the ability to look at each other, or sorry, look at the other, to look at each other, and develop the otherness to develop a real horizontality in learning, and the links between them, and how to enhance in their learning processes, or sorry, their learning resources.
I love the otherness idea. I guess there's no magic rule, but my take on the framework of this discussion is to learn how to self-regulate the amount of exposure that you have to the digital devices. So it's cool to learn with technology, and I work in a technology and education policy, and I'm really happy to do that. But also it's important to teach people to get rid of the digital communications and also talk to each other, looking at their eyes and generating this sense of empathy, which is so important in daily based life. So in previous research, we have explored when people, for instance, they take the MOOCs, these massive open online courses, and they live in this, or they work and learn in this fully digital environment, many of them tend to say, hey, you know what? Why don't we get rid of this thing for a while, and why don't we go to a Starbucks and have a coffee together? And this is, I guess, is a good practice that we have to have in this daily based life outside of technology. And this is really difficult because we tend to spend as much as 8 hours per day online. So if we better regulate the amount of exposure that we have online, and we find a better balance with other people, conversations, those who agree with you, but more importantly, those who think completely different than you, because this will diversify your way of understanding the reality, I think we will consolidate this otherness sense that is so important today in a world that we tend to focus our discussions in our silos of people who think very similar to us.
In this era, it seems that, you know, we're using data not only to evaluate students, but all the aspects of school, and including teachers. And we say that, you know, this is a fair way to evaluate different teachers. And we're starting to see instances where we can have otherwise well-regarded teachers fired for having a low score in an assessment tool. And Cathy O'Neil argues that many of these assessment tools are very opaque. That is, they're not transparent in how they work. Mm-hmm. So at this age of data-driven decision-making, is there a more fair approach to evaluating teachers in addition to how we evaluate students?
You know, 2 years ago or 3 years ago, I was in BET, one of the main firms in the world of educational technology in London. So there was this guy who was offering this incredible tool who was putting CCTV cameras on every classroom. And the principal had a little screen with every single teacher at the same time monitoring the practices. And the guy was selling this thing as an amazing tool to improve teaching. And I was horrified when I was there. And I said, you know what? This thing is not going to help, but also it's going to generate a lot of problems. And one of the main problems that this kind of practices is generating, and this is an example, but we live in a over accountability obsessed society, is we break something that John, you and I have been discussing this topic earlier, is we break the trust. So we have to find a good balance between monitoring without breaking the trust, because if you don't trust the people, we will have this war of learning experience in many other spaces. So, for instance, when we compare the typical example, when we compare Finland with Korea's education system, we see that one of them is based on trust and the other one is based on an obsessed monitoring accountability. So it's up to us to define to which one of them we want to go. Now, the trust is not that naive that I trust you and I leave you to go away. But the trust is based on good quality professionals, is based on providing the good skills and the good training in order to allow them to take better decisions. So OECD few months ago released this report in which they say we have been, the OECD countries have been increasing the spending on education on 20% for the last 10 years. But we haven't changed the performance on PISA tests at all in those 10 years, despite that it's much more expensive than 10 years ago. And I guess with accountability happened the same. You don't get better system only because you have higher level of control. So the Foucault idea of the panoptic is super applicable today into education. And I think this is a problem because you can monitor everyone, but that doesn't mean that you will build better performance. And of course, that will mean that you harm trust.
I think that the issue of trust is super important, especially since we've been, as you say, selling big data systems or data systems as a way to increase trust or trust. You can trust the data more than you can trust individuals. And so I think that's a really important aspect to bring in. We got another comment in or a question. Says, as a result of the standards movement, what happens in schools has become even more compartmentalized. Big ideas are broken into tiny parts and each part is taught slash assessed independently of the whole and never and often never synthesized to show how each part fits into the whole. How do we shift mindsets to allow for evaluating alternative processes and products in a wider view instead of simply evaluating a series of small, disconnected benchmarks?
That's a tough question. that's a really tough one. But it's not a new question, though, I have to say. This is a discussion between having a super specialized curriculum focused on some silos of contents or tending to move into these subject-based discussions in which are much more transversal. This could be an approach. We know today that, for instance, Finland, again, sorry to go again with the same country, but they are moving into this direction, despite that they are ranking very high into the PISA results. Not as high as they used to be, but they're really high in the top countries. And I guess, and this is a question that has been coming again and again, and people feel frustrated into say, I want to have a better education. I want to teach my students better. I want my kids to be in a better school who may have a big picture of some of the problems of reality. They learn how to deal with reality and not they really need to succeed into the curriculum or the assessments. But I feel frustrated because I cannot take my kid out of the system. And I understand this kind of creative tension that is behind. My take is you can be within a system that sometimes tend to narrow down your specificity of knowledge, your competency in some specific areas or core areas, to call it in the more global language today. But also you can encourage those kids to develop other kind of practices while they're in the school, which is like attending some labs out of the classes or some social entrepreneurial initiatives that can encourage and diversify the knowledge in which you can connect the dots from different silos which are separated in the curriculum. And I guess this is one of the main challenges, how to find a good balance between this disaggregated way of understanding the knowledge which we see in a lot of curriculums nowadays, and the outside world, for calling it in a ridiculous way, that is how happened in the internet, in which the knowledge is connected from many disciplines. You and I, John, we always use this quote, this phrase from George Simmons, who says, the network is the learning, and which is this capacity of connecting different sources of knowledge. We may not have anything in common, but if you find a way to use this language, which allows you to explore different kind of knowledge, you will be in a much better shape to later on to redesign the way that you learn and to adapt in a world that is full of uncertainty. Yusai Ito, the director of the Media Lab, this guy used this concept of anti-disciplinarism. And he says, it's not enough to be transdisciplinary, but you have to be able to understand languages of different silos of knowledge in a way that you can connect them and not only understand them. And I guess this is something that we see in a daily based life, in the online world, but has not been landed enough, has not been adopted, embraced enough into the curriculum, I guess.
Thank you. We got another question from Facebook. What do you see as the main differences between the countries that have high PISA results yet are still moving forward more innovatively with alternative learning, teaching, and assessment, and those countries who score less well yet continue the same processes for teaching and learning?
Oh, this is a question that comes again and again many, many times. And it's a great question, but it's super difficult to answer, and at least from my point of view. Because when we compare those fast runner countries who are highly performing, they don't tend to have super clear patterns. For instance, I made a comparison between Korea and Finland, and these two education systems, which rank very high, are almost the opposite, right? One is based on community and the other one is based on discipline. One is based on control and the other one is based on bottom-up decision making. So if you want to draw conclusions out of that, it will be very difficult. And now one of the fast runners, the new star of the last PISA 2016 results, is Vietnam, which has a very, very low income. It's half of the GDP of Uruguay and is in the top five countries in math. So you may wonder, what lessons can we learn out of that? And I went to revise the World Bank reports, and they say they have a highly centralized education system. They tend to use technology more than other neighbor countries, but they are not super high tech. They haven't sorted out the problem of the digital divide, and kids are highly motivated. But there's something that you can draw out of the kind of multi-country analysis. And this is well explained in the book Surpassing Shanghai. You have to have this balance between well-paid teachers, teachers who have enough amount of time to innovate and to find new experiences, and something that is really difficult. You have to value the professional activity of teachers. And this is something that is not only linked with money, has much more to do with social economical support. So if a parent has a kid and the kid may be deciding whether to be, I don't know, a pilot, a lawyer, or a teacher, if parents stay to say it's not a good idea to go to study education, we are in troubles because we are putting first priority kind of careers and second priorities. And these are some of the problems that we identify transversally along different countries. When it's a national pride that you become an educator, you are in the right track, I would say.
Thank you very much. I've got one final question, and this is reorienting back towards the book a bit, but I think it's a real important topic. And maybe it's a topic for a whole nother conversation completely. But O'Neil argues that college ranking algorithms, these entrance exams, and many other data-driven aspects of our lives are really designed to reward the rich. Those are the people who can afford to game the system, to, you know, cheat ethically. And this is really done at the expense of the poor. Perhaps there are some great examples we've been talking about in education, but in other areas as well. She said that in Florida, that adults who have clean driving records but poor credit scores, that means in the past you have not managed their money very well, that they paid an average of $1,552 a year more than the same drivers with an excellent credit, but who have been caught driving drunk. So is there a chance that we're really punishing the poor and the less advantaged with these systems, or it's a consequence of it that was unintended?
Well, the short answer is definitely yes. You know, when I left Oxford, those were the years of the MOOCs, and MOOCs were about to change the world, and universities were about to disappear, and all those sort of things. And we were really excited based on the possibilities of that. And there were a lot of excitement. And then when I moved to Uruguay, I realized this was not even a conversation about MOOCs. It's not that they were risky or not. They were out of the field of discussions, out of the area of interest. So then I learned that this wall of technology and education, but the impact of the digital culture in the daily-based life in a more broad sense, This happened in a kind of parallel universe, from those who generate and produce technology and the more wealthy areas of the world, if you want, and the peripheries of the South Hemisphere in the larger sense. So, of course, there is a big problem out of that, and we need to better link these two. Of course, we know very nice initiatives in which we bridge those gaps, but with all these skills imbalance, with all these new literacies imbalance between regions, the digital divide is evolving into new forms, into new shapes. But at the end of the day, it's still persistent. It's like an onion. We remove in some countries the layer of the access, like Uruguay, who sort out the problem with connectivity in the schools. But the problem is, if you have so many other layers that you have to take into account, and again, one of the big ways of moving forward is to transit from the discussion on smart cities into smart citizens. And this is still in the agenda we have to move forward. Thank you.
Ellen, thank you. So we're about out of time here. So I just want to say thanks again for joining us. It is always a pleasure to chat with you, and it's always been a pleasure to work with you. So thank you again so much for joining us today.
Thank you. Very exciting conversation, and let's keep it online.
We'll keep it online.
Okay.
So our next book for discussion is Peter Hartkamp's Beyond Coercive Education. Details in this book are online at educationfutures.com/reads, and we're going to discuss it next Sunday, which is February 5th at 10 a.m. U.S. Central, or 5 p.m. in Amsterdam, Paris, Madrid, Berlin, Prague. In Uruguay, it's what time? It would be 1 p.m.?
I don't know. We'll put it down.
I know. We'll put it down. We'll figure it out. So thank you for joining us. Let us know, how did this chat go? Please send us your feedback. You can email me directly at john@educationfutures.com. And you can learn a lot more about Education Futures at educationfutures.com. So thanks again, Chris. And thanks to everybody who joined us and posted comments on Facebook during this live stream. And we'll see you next week.
Take care. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.